good, my chasers? It's your boy, I Am Aaron Chase Jr., and we back with another one, y'all. How y'all feeling, man? We got another one right here for y'all. Back to back. How y'all feel about that? Y'all like that or not? Let me know in the comment section down below. For everybody who's brand new to this channel, welcome. Welcome to the Chaser Squad. As I said, my name is I Am Aaron Chase Jr. You can reach me at Twitter and Instagram, because that's where I'm most active at. Right now, y'all, as you seen by the title, today, there's a reason why I'm wearing this hat and this jersey. You seen the title. We about to go over my favorite player on my favorite team. And we about to discuss a few things. One, why he's my favorite. Two, why I don't want to draft another shooting guard. And then three, I'm going to show you the reason why we shouldn't draft another shooting guard. So, how should I start this? Let me think. Give me a second. You know what? Let's do this. Let's start off with some history for y'all folks. But I'm gonna make this fun. I'm gonna make it a fun history class. You hear me? Let me show you some pictures. And if you pick up the pattern as to why I showed you the pictures in this way, let me know in the comment section down below. So let's get it rolling. So, do you see or notice why I posted them pics up the way I did? Well, if you're a Hornets fan and you have the same mind frame that I do, the reason why I posted those pics the way I did is because the first pick is the player in college. The second pick is the player in the NBA. And the first person that you're going to see every time that the picture comes up is the person that we selected, as you see, because you see the jersey. The person that followed them is the next person when they was in college and when they was in the NBA. And then it's supposed to be a compare and contrast. So as you see, for example, the first one is Michael Kidd-Gilchrist, or as we know him as MKG. That's who we selected number two overall because he lost the NBA draft lottery that year when Anthony Davis, from also Kentucky, went to the New Orleans Pelicans. Back then in the NBA, it was like you wanted the person on the team that won the title. You get what I'm saying? And that's what happened. They won the title. So, But also back in the, and shout out to MKG because he come to my store from time to time and I see him. And I seen his parents. His parents real cool people. But like he was always a great defensive guy and hustler. The thing was he really couldn't provide no offense unless it was in the transition. Or unless it was like a putback or a dunk or a layup. Because everybody knows he couldn't shoot, as you seen by the pick. It shot like this. I can't even do it right. I make a shot look good. That's how crazy it is. And then the person right after him is Bradley Beal when he went to Florida versus now being on the Washington Wizards where he's an impending free agent and he can sign a tenant to stay or not. But that's the first comparison right there. Second comparison, as you see, we have Frank Kaminsky, the center out of Wisconsin, who also went to the national title game but did not win. And then you see him in the NBA with us. And then you see, we also have next Devin Booker in Kentucky, and then Devin Booker with the Phoenix Suns. So now, let me do a little more rant with this one. So, I'm going to give y'all the benefit of a doubt who ever thought that Devin Booker wouldn't become great because of the lack of time that he got in college. Now, the thing was, that team was so loaded. If you watch college basketball that year, you realize it was super loaded, that Kentucky team. Everybody automatically wrote that team down as a team that's going to win a title. Same with me. That was my favorite school. And just to give you a little history with me, I was actually going to go there for college. But only had half the money. Everybody was excited for me and all that. I was excited just to be able to go there and see some basketball players who I know go to the NBA every year. Plus, basketball, my favorite sport. And but the thing is, they lost in the Final Four to that Wisconsin team in Frank Kaminsky. So, and as we're going to go over later his stats, you'll see why some people didn't think that he was going to become good. But the thing is, he shined really well in that role that he played for Kentucky. Because you really had two different teams on that same team. You had like the A squad, B squad, 1 squad, 2 squad, whatever you want to call it. You really had 5 guys who started and 5 guys who can come off the bench and basically be starters on a whole other team too. That's how that team was so damn loaded. Then, the next comparison. This really isn't really a comparison as far as different position-wise, because as you see where I'm going, we're going based off of shooting guards because that's what my guy plays. But the reason why I brought this one up is because, you know, you kind of, not saying that we selected the wrong guy or nothing, but hindsight 2020, the way you're looking at it now, we did select the wrong guy. And same thing with Booker, but kind of the opposite. Not really people were expecting him to become great. You know what I'm saying? But it's not because of lack of time or anything. It's because, I don't know. Like, because I watched him in college. The second guy you're going to see in Donovan Mitchell. I watched him in college. The thing was, he was mainly a defensive guy. Just same thing with MKG. I mean, he did a lot of offense too, but he was mainly a defensive guy too. That's what everybody knew him about. Defensive and very athletic. But going back to Malik Monk versus Donovan Mitchell, like I said, hindsight 2020, Donovan Mitchell was a better one, obviously. But at the time, you thought Monk was going to become great because he was a great sparker type scorer. Like, if he got hot, watch out. Like, kind of like J.R. Smith. If he gets on fire, he's on fire. Ask Miami Heat fans who faced the Hornets all the time whenever Malik Monk caught on fire and beat him. He was a Miami Heat killer for us. Anytime we needed a spark, like I remember 2 years ago? Can't remember, because this is first year with Lakers. I can't remember if it was, yeah, I think it was two, it was, I know for sure it was 2 seasons ago. Probably just a year ago, but 2 seasons ago. In a game in Miami. He caught on fire and scored like 36 for us and helped us win that game. So that's that. But it's like also, you know, he had little issues too, so that was another thing too. But then he even came out and said in a couple articles, like, they lied to me and they didn't even give me time. And when they say they, he means James Borrego, the old head coach, the one that recently got fired. And then, now going up to the final person, as you see, my favorite. So, to touch up even more on those comparisons, like I said, the first person that you see is the person that we selected. Second person is who we did not select and who became greater. Now, the crazy thing is, all those guys that became greater, they were selected after the person we picked. That's the crazy part. So now, I'm about to roll into why this guy is my favorite. Kind of tied two and together. So back to the comparison. As you see, it's mainly around shooting guards, right? The tie also is back into Frank Kaminsky. That year that we selected him, we went on to make the playoffs. That was the last time the Hornets made the playoffs. We was literally one game away if purple shirt guy didn't talk shit to Dwayne Wade on the court side. If he would have sat down and just let Dwayne Wade or just, I mean, who knows? Miami could have still won. But that's what makes it worse, is that literally as soon as he started talking shit, that's when Dwayne Wade started turning up. You get what I'm saying? Huh, man. Like, we really stole Game 5 from them in the Miami Heat. And literally, you can literally pull up on YouTube right now, Game 6, Hornets versus Heat. We had the momentum, too. But that guy just had to talk shit. Oh, man. But as I'm going to continue and get that out of my way, we needed it. Like, we chose need over BPA. And this is why I tell people all the time, the draft is for drafting the BPA, best player available. Because you can never go wrong with having talent at the same position or multiple positions where you have great depth. Because anything could happen. Somebody can go down. Anything could happen. You get what I'm saying? So, like, that's what messed us up that draft. And then think about it. We would have had Devin Booker that year, too. And then being able to go to the next year, me not having him. Now, I get it. Al Jefferson was on his last few legs. I get it. And as you see, we still without a center nowadays. So, I get it. But this is why you don't go for need. And why you go for best player available. Now, I know what you're probably saying. But you're saying best player available. Well, what about if a shooting guard is there and needs the best player available? Hold on. I got you. So, as you see, we passed up all these great shooting guards. We got LaMelo last year. I mean, 2 years ago. That was amazing. And I said we was going to get him, too. Everybody was saying, let's get James Wiseman because of the whole center's position that we've been going through. Similar to how my Panthers, we've been going through the left tackle since we got Icky this year. But the thing is the fact that, like I said, we've been going through these shooting guards forever. And I finally felt like we had our guy. And he fell to us. Now, if you go back to the draft and all the talks and all that, he wasn't even supposed to go past number 6, which was OKC, who drafted Josh Giddey. He was projected to go right there. But he fell. So I was jumping up and down. And once it got to our pick and he was still on the board, I knew he was our pick. Now for all y'all who don't think I'm a real fan of him, let me drop this clip right here of when I got invited to the first Hive Society draft night event, and we drafted him. So, you see, I was excited. I was ready. I was ready for my man to ball. Because also he really didn't have to have the ball in his hands. You got Bridges and you got Melo. And even though you got Terry, he can come off the bench. So now you're starting to see why I was a little irate at why Borrego wouldn't play him. You got this top talent in the draft who is known as a scorer, and you don't want to play him to score when he can literally come off the bench? Are you kidding me? But you don't want to play him at all. Now I get it. As soon as the GM, Mitch Kupchak, came out and said what he said, I get it. They was pushing for the playoffs, so that's why you didn't play him. But I kind of wish I would have heard that before the season. That way my expectation wouldn't have been so high for my guy. You get what I'm saying? And that's my fault anyway, because I always tell people all the time, when you set your expectations high, and when I say high, I mean a little too high, that's how you get your feelings hurt. Because you always expect, I'm not saying think negative, but when you expect the least, anything greater, it's gonna make you happy. You see what I'm saying? But like that ties into the first part of why he was my favorite and why he is my favorite. Because we needed a shooting guard bad. And just like how my man said it himself, box office, baby. When he said that, and I seen how excited he was walking through the stadium and all that. Because I remember at the draft, everybody thought that he was pissed. Because he didn't smile or nothing. Now I get it. Yeah, he should have smiled a little bit, but that's him. He had a chip on his shoulder. He was mad as shit that he fell. If everybody's telling you that you're supposed to be here or there, but you fall, you wouldn't be pissed? I know I would. Heck you mean. But like I said, we finally had a shooting guard, man. Because as you see, over the years, we passed on these great shooting guards, and I finally wanted one. Because it was best player available and it filled a need. You see what I'm saying? So now, next part. I'm gonna take y'all into, let's look at these players' stats and let's compare and contrast. And I'm also gonna talk about, and I'm also gonna finish that part off by saying why I don't wanna draft another shooting guard. Alright, y'all. So as you see right here, first up, we have Bradley Beal of the Washington Wizards. First off, we have his Florida stats. So now the first thing I want you to see is the points. Because everybody loves points, especially a shooting guard. You see what I'm saying? 14.8 points per game for his rookie season, freshman season, because that's all he played in college, as you see. Next thing you see is the 6.7 rebounds. After that, 2.2 assists. Also, 1.4 steals. Then the free throws, 76.9. The 3-point field goals, 33.9. So them stats are looking pretty great for a college person, isn't it? And then also another thing, the 4.7 to 10.6 field goals per game at 44.5. So overall, he shoots really, really well, as everybody knows, he was a shooter. But that's college stats. Okay? Next thing, we're gonna compare Devin Booker's college stats. And the reason why I'm comparing all these college stats so that you can know is to compare James Bouknight's to all these other great shooting guards' numbers. Just to see if he's on par, behind, for greatness. You see what I'm saying? So Devin Booker, 10 points per game. Like I said, he's a limited role, so I'll take that into conception. 0.4 steals, 1.1 assists, 2 rebounds, 82.8 free throw, 41.1 3-point percentage, higher than Bradley Beal's. 47% field goal, higher than Bradley Beal's also. But he only shot 3.6 to 7.6 field goals. And like I said, because he was in a limited role, all he really did was catch and shoots and layups and dunks. That's really all he did. He really didn't do too much. So now, let's go to Malik Monk's 1 year. So now also what you're seeing is these first three guards all did 1 year. Keep that in mind also. So, 19.8 points per game. That's the highest so far, isn't it? 0.9 steals. Okay. So, not that much of a defender. Same thing with Booker. 2.3 assists. 2.5 rebounds. 82.2 free throw. 39.7 3-point. 45 percent field goals. But now look at the shots. 6.6 to 14.7. So he puts up the most shots out of anybody did so far. Keep that in mind. And also another thing to touch up on Malik Monk with that draft and Donovan Mitchell is the fact that we've also could have had Bam Adebayo and that would have solved our center position too. But I don't like thinking too much in the past. So let's just stick to the narrative right here also, which is the shooting guards. Next, Donovan Mitchell, college highlights. I'm tired, y'all. But I'm getting this footage out for y'all. Well, let's restart. So, now, for Donovan Mitchell's college stats. So, as you've seen his first year, 7.4 compared to 15.6 in his second year. So, you've seen the growth right there. 0.8 steals compared to 2.1. So he got even better as a defender, even though he already came in as a defender. 1.7 assists to 2.7 assists. Became more of a playmaker because he started having the ball more in his hands. 3.4 rebounds to 4.9. 75.4 free throw percentage to 80.6. 3-point percentage field goal at 25 to 35.4. Drastically improved that number by double digits. That's great. But then the field goal percentage, I'm not disappointed with that because even without looking at them numbers over there, as you see him looking right at y'all at the camera, and that field goal, the amount of field goals he puts up, going from 44.2 to 40.8, obviously by him having the ball more in his hands and putting up more shots, the percentage is going to go down a little bit because you're putting up more shots. Now, because it stayed over 40, that should be amazing. You should be very, very happy with that. So now the field goals. 2.7 to 6.1 compared to 5.3 to 13.1. Like I just said. And now, let's compare my guys' stats from college. So, first year, 13 points a game. Compared to 18.7 points per game. 0.8 steals. Compared to 1.1. 1.3 assists. Compared to 1.8. 4.1 rebounds. Compared to 5.7. 82.2 free throws per percentage. Compared to 77.8. 34.7 3-point field goal percentage compared to 29.3. And then 46.2 field goal percentage compared to 44.7. The field goals, 4.6 to 9.9 to 6.5 to 14.6. So, as you can clearly tell, my guy's not the best shooter out of all these guys. Compared to these guys, he's not the best shooter. He's not really that much of a shooter compared to them. But his shot is still good and it still goes in. And in case you don't think that, just type in YouTube James Bouknight, and the first thing that you're going to see pop up, more than likely, is his 24-point game against the Sacramento Kings, which I happen to watch in person. Which, let me drop this clip right here so y'all can see I was actually there in person. So you say, that was actually there. You see me raising my hands up like this. Because I was like, my man getting it. My man finally getting this opportunity. So I ain't even worried. So now, let's go to these people's NBA highlight. I mean, there I go again. Let's compare these guys' NBA stats to James Bouknight, which is going to tie into why I don't think people should be giving up on him as fast as they are and wanting to draft a shooting guard. And so what I'm going to do is, because these guys played a lot, I'm just going to go based off of points. And then I'm going to go into the averages for everything. Since these guys played a lot of years, I'm not about to go over each row in each column. Too much. You get what I'm saying? So here we go. Bradley Beal started off with 13.9 points. Another thing too, I'm going to go over games played. Because that's another thing that's very key in this also. I'm going to go over games played. 13.9 points. Then goes up to 17.1, 15.3, as you see. Starts getting the 20 range. Then his last 3 years started getting into the 30 range. Overall, 20 game score. So now let's go to games played. Rookie year, 56. Started 46 of them. How many minutes? 31.2. So now y'all can look up the rest of them stats for yourselves, to be honest. But I just really want to touch on games played, games started, minutes, and then look at the points, the trajectory of their careers. Because that's the main points I'm going to hit on when I get to my guy, Bouknight. Now we have Devin Booker. Again, 13 range. Gets into the 20 range the next year. And pretty much consistently been a high 20 points per game score. But we all know he can go for 30 any night. Now let's look at this. 76 games played, 51 games started, 27.7 minutes starting as a rookie. Now let's go to Malik Monk, who he kind of is more similar to right now in his career because of the minutes, the game start, the game played, all that. So, points per game, 6.7 in the rookie year, 8.9. Finally started hitting the double digits 3 seasons ago. And still in that lower tier, you see what I'm saying? Because he's never really been integrated to the starter, really. He's always been that bench person for us. Now, with the Lakers, I'm not sure what he did because, honestly, I spend too much time and money on my own team. I really don't pay attention to anybody else unless I've seen them before and know who they are or hear about them all the time. Now, let's go to games played. 63. 0 games started. 13.5 minutes. And as you've seen, he's never started a game for us except that one time. 2019-2020. You see that? So this guy, pretty much this lottery pick, has never translated to be that starting shooting guard for us like these other guys that turned out to be. So you see why I'm super high on Bouknight and why I think he could be our guy? Because you've been looking for that guy for a long time to be the starting shooting guard. That way you can have a good, young backcourt, stay together and stay connected. And as you see, he finally started starting some games for the Lakers. 37 of them. But you see, forget that one game right there. Pretty much none for us in his first 4 years. You see that? And that was high on Monk, by the way. That's the first Hornets jersey I ever bought. Now, yes, a lot of y'all gonna probably be like, dang, he a young fan. I don't care. That's the first jersey I bought. Because it's the first time I went to a game. I'll drop that picture right here for y'all. I don't care. Here y'all go. So as you see, that was my first game ever. Had the monk jersey, seen some honeybees, seen Hugo. It was good. But now, let's go to Mitchell. So, started off the gates hot at 20.5. And by the way, a lot of people got caught off guard by this because, I mean, obviously the Jazz have always been this veteran-type team, but they always needed a superstar, and he became the superstar right off the bat. Even some of the Jazz people in the organization said that they were shocked that he translated that quickly and became that star. And they made it to the playoffs and beat OKC. Remember when OKC had Carmelo, Westbrook, and Paul George? He beat that team. So started off at 20 game already as a rookie. And pretty much same thing throughout. 79 games played, 71 games started. Always been 30 minute game. So now, before I get to Bouknight, as you see with Mitchell, he was picked later than Bouknight was picked. And you telling me this guy couldn't play? Like I said, I get it, they was pushing for the playoffs, but you still telling me you couldn't find no damn minutes? And for all my Hornets fans out there, y'all know, Borrego was always saying, oh yeah, I'm going to find the minutes, I'm going to find the minutes. Like, it used to piss me off, man. I raked the crap out of me. Like, I wanted to bang Borrego my damn self. Like, every game, after every game, I would be out there waiting for the players. Seeing them drive by, say hi, whatever. Just wanted to see him. And a few times, Borrego, majority of the time, stops, lowers his window, say something. That day after Bouknight and Borrego got in that altercation, that day also added even more fuel to him being my favorite player. Because I'm from Baltimore, and he from Brooklyn. And pretty much as both in the Northeast of the United States. And we all got that. I wouldn't say like arrogance to us, like when you cross the line with us, but like if you cross the line with us and treat us a certain type of way, you got it with us. But like, that added some fuel right there, because also I don't like how my guy was treated, man. You ain't had to do that to him like that out there. But then, like I said, I wanted to bang Borrego myself. I asked him, like, what the fuck was that? What the hell was that in there? And then he said, have a good day, and left. I was pissed. I was pissed. So now, let's get to my guy's NBA stats. So, 4.6 points per game. And now let's go over to games played. 31. Game started. None. Minutes per game. 9.8. So, I was shocked when I seen this, but there was a stat that had came out that Bouknight was the first rookie pick in the lottery to not play a certain amount of minutes, and I was shocked by that. And like, if you watch the NBA this year, for example, and I mentioned this in the video that I did of GM Mitch Kupchak, you had the Pelicans rookies, specifically Herb Jones, who was picked in the second round, played more minutes than Bouknight did. You had that Chicago Bulls rookie, who's known for defense. I think it's number 12, with the dreads. He played more minutes than Bouknight. You had the guy Bones Highland, who played for the Denver Nuggets. He's played more minutes. Now, granted, There was an injury for Jamal Murray all year, so he was able to get the minutes. But you see how that made him better? That accelerated him. Because now he got playoff minutes. So now would you really know what you got out of him? Now that's the main thing. We don't know what we got out of James Bouknight. I mean, all we can really count on is that Kings game. You get what I'm saying? Because that was a game where he really played the most. And that's one thing that kills me. Because we really don't know what we got out of him. But I see a potential stud. And shout out to my man Israel. I'm going to post his Twitter right here. Because he says the same thing. But, like, that's what I'm so irate by this, man. And then you come out as a coach and say, oh, I'm gonna find the minutes, find the minutes. But you don't even find minutes. I'm telling you, y'all, we will be up. We will be up by 15 to 20 plus points with, like, 6 minutes left. And he won't put them in. He won't put the rookies in until, like, 2 minutes left. And the guy and the other coach already threw in the towel. Like, what? That is extra valuable minutes that they can be getting. There's no better teacher in life than experience. So now the experience that Herb Jones got in Bones Highland is going to go great for them. And the rookie from Chicago. Because now they got to see some real minutes. You get what I'm saying? The only real time that Bouknight really got to shine was when we had that time where we had the health protocol going on where Melo was out, Gordon was out, and it was somebody else. I can't remember if it was Rozier or Bridges, can't remember. But I know those two were out for sure, Gordon and Melo. And that's where it really got to shine. That's where you seen this gem right here that I'm about to drop for y'all. So this is why I'm so high on Bouknight and why I don't want to draft another shooting guard. Because one, I don't want to hinder anything on him, and he should have gotten more time to play. Now, if he really got more time to play and I knew what he had, then yes, maybe I would consider it. But the fact that also we still have Rozier here and he really hasn't gotten that much time is why also I'm considering letting Rozier stay. Because then after he plays 1 year consistently coming off the bench with some high minutes, and if he excels really, really well, which I believe he can, because by watching him in person, anytime he came in, he really grabs rebounds and can score the ball well, drives to the basket, creates so much space that my man Israel also showed me. And, like, that's my main thing. I don't want to hinder anything on him. I want to give him the rock. I want to let him go, play, have fun. And so now, y'all, now that we done with that part, I'm about to show y'all all these videos, pics, and y'all gonna see why he's my favorite. And also, before I get started with all that, I'm gonna show you this right here that comes from a journal that I wrote in all the time. This is when it started. When I wanted to see Bouknight play, or I really felt like he had times to play, and where I wanted to see him either after the game, before the game, whenever, to get a pic with him, or to get him signed one of these jerseys. Because if you know me and you see me on Twitter, I have two of these, and I was always trying to get one signed. It was a plan of mine. And believe it or not, I'm so very grateful that dream actually came true, as you'll see. And that's my homie right there, man. Love him. Can't wait for him to become a star and shine. So now, here goes all the pics, videos, everything. Enjoy the movie. See y'all in a couple seconds. I'm in this bitch, man. In this bitch.
Hey, y'all, they trying to get my hopes up, man. They know I want Bouknight, and they trying to get my hopes up, man. I'm telling you, the Panthers, if the... Panthers, my dumb ass. What's it called? If the Pelicans pick him, bro, I'm going to be pissed. I'm going to throw this fucking phone.
What I told you, man. I'm happy as shit.
That hat looking fresh as fuck with me right now, man. You see the fit?
Man, what I told y'all, man. I'm sorry, Monk, you out, man. I enjoyed the time, man, but you out, man. We got a guard, man. We got a real guard now, man.
Bro, that's Bouknight. Yo, that's Bouknight. I cannot believe it, bro. I need to get up there so I can pull down my window, but these people in front of me, dang it.
this, man. I get to see my man Bouknight practice for the first time ever out here, man. I gotta record this, man. Man, Book, man. Let's go, Book. Hit them shots, man. Hit them shots, man. Let's go, man. Hit them shots, man. I was watching your highlights the other night, bro. Got it. Freshman and sophomore season. Hit them shots, man. Let's go. Hit them shots, man. My man, Brad.
Alright, bro, now you can see me for real. So, bro, this right here is where the players and coach come out. I'm gonna talk to his ass when his ass come out here, bro, JB. I see him every fucking night after every home game, bro. That shit pissed me off, bro. I'm gonna fight his ass. I'm gonna come right at him and be like, yo, what the fuck was that? What the fuck you do to him? Why you treating him like this? For real, bro, that shit pissed me off. I seen that shit live.
Oh,
y'all see my guy right there putting in that work, man.
You just gotta win tonight.
My guy putting in that work.
Place. I hope Houston wins. If Houston wins, we're good.
Listen, man, I just got the signed jersey from last game.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, okay. I ain't get it signed by him, but I had bought it.
Oh, nice.
I'm trying to get it signed by him.
Right, for real.
It's right in there. The one I got on right now is right in there. I've been trying to get that signed for a minute.
Got
here
a little bit earlier.
I mean, how do you get this job? Fucking certified rebounder.
Shoot, I wish I could get that.
Right?
Anytime he called me, hey, I need some rebounders for 2 o'clock in the morning. Shoot, I will be right over there.
I got you.
Yeah, exactly. Line, man. My man don't miss.
Certified rebounder.
My man does not miss. He was not lying about that pre-workout.
Y'all
want
to go see DC talking about? Kaka.
That's my guy, man. My guy does not miss. My guy does not miss. My guy does not miss. I don't know how many shots he hit in a row. I gotta watch his back.
I can smell my face.
Ah. Yo, he going inside my jersey, bro.
This is what I wanted, bro. Yo, I could cry right now, man. And I got that on tape. That's my guy. That's my guy. That's my guy. You see what I got on, right? Hell yeah, that's my guy. Appreciate that, man.
No problem.
So the Hornets still looking for their first scratch, close to 2 minutes into our game. There it is! With some power! PJ Washington, get your jammies on!
Yo, he going inside my jersey, bro. This is what I wanted, bro. Yo, I could cry right now, man. And I got that on tape.
After watching that movie, does that just make y'all feel so great, man? Like, that's my guy. You see how much love I have for him. And nobody can't tell me I wasn't a true fan from the beginning. Because I really am, man. That's my guy. I want him to excel really, really well. Become a cornerstone of this franchise, just like Melo and Bridges. So now, y'all, that's the end of it, Hornets fam. Tell me what y'all think. If you agree with me, disagree, what's your take, let me know. Give a like, comment, subscribe, join the Chaser Squad. See y'all later, man. You already know what to do. No excuses. Chase your dreams. Be you. Do you. We out.